Hi, everyone. I'm Pastor Heidi Hester, and I serve the congregation of Trinity Lutheran Church here in Pleasanton, California. We welcome you to this time of worship with our prayer service and message for the fifth Sunday in the Easter season. We are glad that you have decided to come and join us for this time to be reminded of God's love for you, that God meets you where you are with whatever you're struggling with, whatever your joys, your sorrows, your fears, your hopes are. God meets you where you are today and reminds you that we are connected. We are connected with God and we are connected with one another. And we hope that this time together reminds you of that and gives you hope and strength for the week to come. As in the Easter season, we begin with a prayer and a thanksgiving for our baptismal promises that we have received in Christ Jesus. So let us pray. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. So refreshed by the resurrection life that we share in Christ, we give thanks for the gift of baptism. O risen Christ, we thank you for the waters where you make us new, for leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, O risen Christ, that your Spirit comes to us in grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and your forgiveness, and send us companions on our journey as we share in your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts, shower us with life, and to you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit and the glory of God now and forever. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of John, the 15th chapter. This takes place the night before Jesus is crucified and is often called the farewell discourse. And so this is Jesus talking to his disciples. Jesus said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and burned. But if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples." This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, grace to you and peace from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, one thing that I have learned in my years up here serving in Northern California is this. Great wine is always a reflection of a particular vineyard. If you want to pick a good wine, you have to know the source of that wine. Now, I know if you drink wine, you have your favorites, right? Because each one is a reflection of the climate, the type of grape, the composition of the soil, the weather, all sorts of things go in to make that perfect glass of wine. You can almost taste it now. But if you don't like wine, no worries, because you don't have to be a connoisseur of the wine itself to appreciate and love the beauty that the vineyards bring to areas such as Northern California. I mean, the acres of vines covering the hillsides, the leaves, the grapes, all the clusters, all of it create this almost fantasy background to a place where a lot of people pay a lot of money to escape a couple of days. It's just that wonderful sense of being a place to be and to belong. Remember, great wine is always a reflection of a particular vineyard. So this gospel text should relate a bit to us, at least those of us who are in Northern California or in wine growing regions. Perhaps it's a bit more contextual than our sheep from last week. So if great wine is a reflection of a particular vineyard, then being a great disciple of Christ is a reflection of belonging to God. I am the vine, you are the branches, says Jesus. This is actually one of his last I am statements that he makes in the Gospel of John. As I said before, it takes place on the eve of his crucifixion. Jesus knows what is about to happen to him, and he is attempting to prepare the disciples to carry on without him, to remind them that even though he is not there, they are still connected to what God is doing in the world. They are there to be reminded that God's love and healing will continue to flow through them, even when Jesus is no longer with them. But I want us to take a notice of something in this passage. I think oftentimes we gloss over it. Notice that the disciples are not the fruit, the end product. No. But they become the very conduit for the vine's nourishment to the fruit, because they are the branches. I think that's a very important distinction. Like I said, we oftentimes just kind of gloss over it. Because if the branches are not able to carry the nutrients to the fruit, the quality of the fruit suffers. It becomes sour or bitter or just doesn't ripen. So by belonging to the vine and being the branches, Jesus is reminding the disciples and us how important that interconnected relationship is with him. It's a relationship connected by mutuality. It is a relationship that depends upon one another in order to bear good fruit. I don't know if you've looked at a grapevine recently or closely, but when you look at it, all the branches from each vine are intertwined with one another, and it's difficult to see them apart from each other. They twist and curl around one another, and you can't tell where one starts or one ends. But the thing is that even though we are all interconnected, we are all connected to the vine as a branch. Because the quality of branches and fruit depends solely on the quality of the connectedness to the main vine. We have to think about it this way. Branches are fruit bearing, not fruit making. A branch itself can't make the fruit, make the wine on its own. If it's not connected, it dries up and it withers and it's no longer useful and it must be pruned. What is no longer useful is thrown away to allow new life to sprout from it. There is something sort of passive about being a branch, but that's not a bad thing. Because you see, that branch, that passiveness, becomes the conduit of that nourishment that helps the fruit to blossom, that helps the fruit to get sweet, that helps the fruit to be what it should be. Branches do what they are made to do. They receive life and they give it. And they do it again and again and again. As long as they are connected to the vine, they do what they do. Now I want to set the image of the vine aside for a second, let it rest for a bit, because I want to talk to you about this new book that I just ordered. It came out in 2019, but the title of it, I think, says it all. The title of this book is, If You Know Who You Are, You Know What to Do. As I said, it was a book written in 2019 by Ron Greer. But what really caught me, not only was the title, But the book review for this, and I want to read that to you. So here's the book review. Author Ron Greer delivers a timely message in an uncertain time. The world, as we know it, is changing. And at the end of the day, there are fewer and fewer things that we are sure of. Greer reminds us of the importance of staying true to oneself, of staying true to who we are and who we are destined to be. His book provides a pathway to rediscovering our core values of compassion and honesty and respect, focusing on the attributes that help us to remain anchored in any storm. Recognizing and rejoicing in who we are truly will help us to make those life-defining decisions that determine the quality of our days and lead us all to better tomorrows. Now that's a book review. And I hope that his groundedness in being a Christian and his thought process will lead to some interesting discoveries. I'll keep you posted on that one. But it intrigued me. Let's go back to the text for a second, because I think this book really sums up what our gospel text is all about. Because Jesus is reminding the disciples who they are, who we are, and what we are meant to be doing. Reminding them that if they know who they are, they will know what to do. Brilliant. Wish it was that easy, but maybe it is. I mean, let's think about this. Let's go back to that vine image. When we think about it, that initial read of this passage could be daunting and maybe even fearful making a bit. Bear fruit or else they'll be thrown into the fire. Well, that's really becomes a text about condemnation, and that's not what Jesus is saying. Because I think this text is really just a statement of life for us. Because without being connected to a life source, that abundant life that we are promised in Christ Jesus is not possible. We don't strike out on our own to bear fruit, because when we do, we fail because that fruit hasn't received what it has needed from the vine. We try and do a lot of things on our own. Sometimes we succeed, sometimes we fail. But if we're not connected to the one who knows us intimately, who knows us and calls us and loves us in spite of ourselves, then that nourishment that we carry out into the world that looks like love and peace and hope and wholeness and healing and justice and mercy is not exactly what God has intended. Because if you know who you are, you know what to do. If you remain in close relationship with God, the rest of your life will bear fruit. Because when we're connected, when we're in close relationship with one another and with God, that abundant resurrection life we have in Christ is made clear to us and to those around us. And we can't help but not do what we have to do. I want to read Jesus' words again, but this time from the Message. And he says this: live in me. Make your home in me just as I do in you. And in the same way that a branch can't bear grapes by itself, but only by being joined to the vine, you can't bear fruit unless you are joined with me. I am the vine, you are the branches. When you're joined with me and I with you, the relation intimate and organic, the harvest is sure to be abundant. Separated, you can't produce a thing. I think this message is very relevant for us here in May of 2021. Because this is an image that illustrates our profound dependence on the one who first breathed life into us. Because it is only that life that we are the conduits of to make sure that the life around us is abundant. For us, for our families, for our friends, for our communities, for the whole creation itself. When we try to do it on our own, we get caught up in all of those things that are stumbling blocks for us. We get caught up in our egos, in our anger, in our revenge, and it doesn't work because we are no longer connected to the source of that unconditional love and grace that God has first given us and that are given to us again in the death and resurrection of Christ Jesus. Because life is nothing without belonging to something. As we learned last week, we belong to the shepherd. And this week, we belong to the vine. We are the branches. Because without belonging, without intimacy, without relationship, life just doesn't seem to be fulfilled. I mean, we can't begin to tackle huge issues as poverty and crime and education and lack of housing and sustainability if we can't even be connected to the one who first breathed life into us. We can't possibly think that we can make a difference by ourselves across this celestial globe when we refuse to acknowledge how each and every one of God's creation is connected to one another deeply and intimately. And if we can't see that, then what's the purpose? We can't begin to think that we are able to be a conduit of God's resurrection hope and love when we have separated ourselves from the community of God's vineyards by the things that we have done and the things that we have left undone. God's presence and love is most revealed in us and through us when we love one another. Our relationship with God is strongest when we love one another. We don't grow closer to God by receiving love, but by giving love. We are the branches. God is the vine. God's love is incarnational and transformational, and it comes from belonging and being connected to that vine. If you know who you are, then you know what to do. To know who you are, you need to be connected and stay connected. Connected to the source of goodness in life. Connected in worship, in reading scripture, and praying and meditating. Stay connected by bringing food to the food pantry. Reach out to your neighbor and check on them. Pray for them. Find out who they are. Connect with someone who might make it possible to rebuild, say, our preschool or some the community that's falling apart. Donate to your favorite charity. Whatever you do, whatever makes your heart sing, and whatever you know God to be calling you to do, do it. Because if you know who you are, you know what to do. Because, my friends, you are the Easter people. You are people who are redeemed, claimed, beloved, and you are people who have been richly blessed by God's love. It is who you are. So be bold. You know what to do. Amen. Part of being connected to that vine is taking time to be in relationship and conversation with God. We do that through prayer. So I would invite you to join with me in prayer this day as we bring those concerns, those joys, those sorrows into God's loving hands. So let us pray. God of all fruitfulness, you abide in us, your church, and your church abides in you. Cleanse us by your word and give yourself to the whole church on earth so that it bears fruit and witness to your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You have created the heavens and the earth, and as we wonder at the beauty of creation, may we seek vital connections among all that depends on the earth for life. Help us be good stewards and be connected to one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You rule the nations with justice and love. Give all leaders of the earth assurance of your abiding presence, so that they may lead not by fear or anger or power, but with love for those that they are called to serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You have loved us so that we can love others. We pray this day for all in need of your love. Those who are in our hearts, those who we speak aloud, and those whom we don't even know. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You gather us with all of the saints by the power of your Spirit. With them, may our hearts live forever in your keeping. Keep us connected to you in all that we do, in all that we say, in all that we share. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, make us bold to call you our Father as we pray the prayer that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now receive God's blessing for this week. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Christ. May the God of life bless you now and forever. Amen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Now go in peace and share this good news. Thanks be to God. Amen.